Call to order the Brentwood Board of Aldermen regular meeting for December 19th. If you'd all rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
You allowed to do that in Columbia?
I was going to ask you.
Roll call, please.
Alderman Plufka.
Here.
Alderman Weggie.
Here.
Alderman Lockmiller.
Here.
Alderman Kramer.
Present.
Mayor Thornton.
Here.
Alderwoman O'Neill. Alderman Leahy.
Here.
Alderwoman Sims.
Here.
Alderman Dimmitt.
Here.
All right. For those of you in the audience, just so you're aware of what's going on here tonight, Alderman Kramer is in Columbia with his wife and his wife's family, and he's joining us tonight vis-a-vis webcam. So we can actually see him. You all can't, but that's what's required by the state regulations for him to vote, so we have to be able to see him. But he is here, and the voice you'll hear coming out of this box from time to time will be his voice, and he'll participate in tonight's meeting just as if he were sitting right here. So that's what's going on with that. Item number three on the agenda is approval of tonight's agenda. Are there any changes to tonight's agenda? Alderman Lockmiller.
I'd like to make a motion under item number 11 that we flip-flop item 11B and 11C. So 11B will be Bill 6106, and item 11C will be 6105.
All right. Been moved.
Second, Your Honor.
All right, it's been moved and seconded to flip-flop items 11B and C. Is there any discussion? Okay, seeing none, all in favor say aye.
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 Are there any opposed? All right, great. Items B and C will be flip-flopped. Any further changes to tonight's agenda?
Motion to approve the agenda as amended.
Second.
Moved and seconded that the board approve the agenda as amended. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Are there any opposed? Great. We have an agenda for this evening. Item number four on the agenda, consideration and approval of the minutes of the December 5th Board of Aldermen meeting. Are there any changes or amendments to the minutes as submitted? Seeing none, any objection to approving by acclamation? Great, they're approved. Item number five on the agenda, we have a couple of items of recognition tonight. So the first one is one of our own detectives in the police force. Detective Eisenbeis was recognized by the Brentwood Chamber of Commerce as the Citizen of the Year in Brentwood for his work with the schools and with the Neighborhood National Night Out. Thank you. Wanted to say Neighborhood Watch. But anyway, we have a proclamation, and I'm just going to go ahead and read it to you. If I can get the right one up in front of me. Whereas Detective Eisenbeis has been named Citizen of the Year by the Brentwood Chamber of Commerce for his dedication to the community during his 25 years of service with the Brentwood Police Department, and whereas the Brentwood Chamber of Commerce annually honors an individual for his or her contribution in making Brentwood a better place to live and work by contributing in developing social and economic well-being of our city, and whereas Detective Eisenbeis serves as the school resource officer and DARE officer for all Brentwood schools, and whereas Detective Eisenbeis is a volunteer and fundraiser for the Missouri Special Olympics and organizes National Night Out block parties for the City of Brentwood Police Department, and whereas Detective Eisenbeis organizes and volunteers several hours to the Backstoppers Barbecue event sponsored each year by the Brentwood Police and Fire Departments, therefore, I, Christopher Allen Thornton, Mayor of the City of Brentwood, do hereby congratulate Detective Craig Eisenbeis for his many years of service to our community and give special recognition for being named Brentwood Chamber of Commerce Citizen of the Year. All right. The second proclamation we have tonight is relates to one of our local businesses, and this is one we all know and love. And you may not know that they've been here for 80 years. So this is West Community Credit Union's 80th anniversary in the city of Brentwood. And with us are Jason Peach, who's the CEO, and Stephanie Tyler, who's a member of the West Community Credit Union Board. So here's the proclamation. Whereas on June 5th, 1936, 15 Brentwood businesses and civic leaders formed Brentwood Mutual Credit Union at the new Brentwood City Hall. That's this place, in the garage. Whereas they soon expanded and moved into Blay Eicher's Barbershop to allow for regular business hours, and whereas after 20 years in the barbershop, the credit union moved into the Jordan Real Estate office where it remained until 1976, when it moved into the location it is at today at 2345 South Brentwood Boulevard. And whereas in 1986, they expanded their service and changed their name to West Community Credit Union. And whereas West Community Credit Union is known for staying ahead of the financial product and technology curve while continuing to offer members superior levels of service for the past 80 years. Now, therefore, I, Christopher Allen Thornton, Mayor of the City of Brentwood, do hereby congratulate West Community Credit Union for 80 years of service and commitment to the City of Brentwood. And last, but certainly not least, we have our own staff who've been recognized for Certificate of Achievement for Excellence in Financial Reporting presented to the City of Brentwood for our Comprehensive Annual Financial Report for the fiscal year ended December 31st, 2015. This is kind of a big deal, folks. This is the CAFR that you've heard so much about in our budget discussions. This is the Government of Financial Officers Association that is recognizing Brentwood as one of the outstanding cities for producing their CAFR each year. And it's my pleasure to produce this Award of Financial Reporting Achievement to Karen Shaw, our Director of Finance. All right, that's all the fun stuff. Yeah, we got other stuff to do tonight. All right, so item number 6 on the agenda, I don't believe we have any public hearings scheduled for this evening. Item number 7, we have two bids this evening. The first is a bid for accounting services. Bola, this one's yours?
Not
or Karen's?
Karen's,
great.
As we discussed at the Ways and Means Committee meeting, we are recommending the firm of Lisa Wright. I'm sorry, not Lisa Wright. She was the highest bidder. Daniel Jones at $19,000 for auditing. And we are recommending for accounting services, Boats Deal at $12,000. Bola and I both interviewed these two firms. They came with very good references. Particularly for the auditing firm, they have a group that's dedicated just to governmental accounting. That's a good thing for us because sometimes you get them where they audit many other different things, which means they specialize in that. So that was something that really caught my attention. The other thing is we would recommend best practices that we split that out rather than have the same company do both the accounting and auditing, because as it was put to me in a GFOA conference, that's like auditing in your own work. So we are recommending that we go with two separate firms, which is why we have two different names we're giving you tonight. Based on my memo, and they weren't necessarily the lowest, but there were other considerations, their quality of work, their peer reviews. That's our recommendation for those two firms, and I will be happy to answer any questions.
Are there any questions for Director Shaw? Alderman Leahy, sorry.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'd like to talk about the point differential between the Bolts deal and Patrick Smith.
Mm-hmm.
You said that you scored them. Mm-hmm. How much pointage difference am I looking at?
I believe, if I'm not mistaken, Ebola, the Daniel Jones was the one with the peer review, the
yes.
negative peer review.
No, it was Smith Patrick.
Oh, that's right.
Had Patrick the negative
Smith.
Peer.
Right.
Yes.
Okay. And thus, the point that causes his points to drop.
Correct.
Down.
Furthermore, they have not audited any municipal government, and because we have TIFs and we have TDDs, it was important to select a firm that had significant experience doing this type of work.
Thank right. you. That helps me.
Are there any further questions for
Good.
Thank
right,
you.
Thank you.
Let's see, we got both 7A and 7B in one shot, so we're going to move on to item number 8 on the agenda. Hearing of any matter of public interest upon the request of any person present. If anyone would care to come forward and address the board, you'll have 3 minutes to talk on the subject of your choice.
Hi, good evening. My name is Danielle Thompson, and I represent the Fraternal Order of Police Lodge 15. And we're here tonight to discuss Ordinance 6101 that the board plans on doing a second reading of later on this evening. I'd like to discuss some of the proposals that are included in this ordinance and some of the ramifications that would come about if this ordinance was passed as written. There are many issues in a public sector bargaining situation for police officers in Missouri that I can't address in 3 minutes. I can't address in 30 minutes or 3 hours. It's a very, very detailed and intricate situation that I encourage you all to be sure to sit down and take very seriously. I will gladly come back anytime to meet with any of you all to discuss any ordinance, to discuss any framework, to discuss just the collective bargaining process for police officers in Missouri in general. Because of that, I'll limit my issues tonight to three of the biggest issues that I see with the ordinance, and that is that designating full-time non-supervisory employees as the most appropriate unit, and that supervisory personnel can't be included in that same unit as employees as they supervise. This basically has said that the city has already made the determination that it figured out what the most appropriate unit is. However, it did not contact us. It didn't try to discuss the unit or attempt to come to an agreement on the employees to be included in the unit. Since there's no process in the framework that allows for appeals of this determination that the city has already made, this creates problems. Because if there's no process for it, that leaves us as the union the only place to go to have issues with it in the courts. We don't want to have to bring a suit to try and figure out what an appropriate bargaining unit is. So we'd like to have something that provides for that, not only in an ordinance, but prior to a framework being adopted. The city administrator validating the signatures on the cards, you've stated in the ordinance that in 3.5, the framework attempts to ensure that the privacy and security of each employee's vote is verified. So if you have the city administrator dealing with the signatures on the cards, that creates a problem of security, of making sure that the validity of this procedure is done correctly. Therefore, we would ask that there is a neutral third party that does this, as opposed to a city official. And then also that the election be required to receive 50% of all eligible voters. If that was the case, some of you wouldn't be here, because anytime you have a vote, you have 50% of the people who voted. That's what matters, not 50% of all of the eligible voters. That's not how democracy works. That's not how regular elections work. The ordinance has many other issues. Like I said, I don't have time to discuss all of those tonight, but we welcome the opportunity to work with the city and urge you all, the Board of Aldermen, to reconsider this ordinance for collective bargaining. We would welcome the opportunity to collaborate with you on a collective bargaining framework. We're always open. As it stands currently, though, the city's proposed framework includes many provisions that may result in strained labor relations and ultimately end up in legal actions, which neither side wants. Thank you.
Thank you.
Louise Charbonneau, 8833 Madge. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Mayor. To the previous speaker's point, I believe, is this not the first time that uniformed police officers are allowed to have collective bargaining in the state? Previously, I looked at the statute and firefighters were permitted, but I don't think police officers were because of the necessity of their being on duty. So I understand that that's a new process and everyone is feeling their way, so good luck to you all. At the Ways and Means, I tried to introduce a concept of you all with your approach to the budget of trying to determine what are the needs of the city and what are the wants of the city. The needs are things that we have to have. The wants are the wish list, I suppose. We all have want lists. Alderman Lockmiller pointed out that Manchester Road topped all three of the sections of the current study that's going underway for our new comprehensive plan. So keep that to the forefront. We heard good news the other day that MoDOT is finally getting ready maybe to come our way, since their plan is to go all the way to Lindbergh, but they may just be doing the roadbed. So that's gonna put the niceties, the sidewalk and curbs on us. So I hope we're gonna be prepared, and if we have to go to reserves, maybe we have to go to reserves. I applaud many of the things that you all have come up with fiscally this year. Alderman Wege having a shoot for a 50% fund balance reserve. And I've said this before, I don't come here planning to speak, but I try to speak for every man, at least every man and woman who's a septuagenarian. And because we live in a country where I can, I do, because there are so many places around the world where we can't, and that's why I'm here. And so that you don't have to hear me at the end of the meeting, I wish you all a very Merry Christmas and a happy and prosperous New Year. And as always, thank you for your service.
Thank you. Is there anyone else that would care to address the board this evening? Going once, going twice. Do we have any aldermanic response? Okay, seeing none. There's nothing unfinished business, I don't believe. Okay. Item number 10 on the agenda, bills to be given a first reading only. Mr. City Attorney, bill number 6110 by title only, please.
Bill number 6110, first reading. An ordinance authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to enter into and execute a professional services agreement with Cook & Riley LLC on behalf of the city of Brentwood, Missouri, for reviewing of citywide sales tax revenue, and further authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to execute a contract on behalf of the city commencing on February 1, 2017 and providing for the effective date of this ordinance.
All right, thank you. Alderman Kramer, normally I'd have you read this, but my understanding is that the sound is hard to get into the city system, so I'll do a substitute job, although poorly. Synopsis, Bill 610. This bill is for an ordinance to authorize the mayor to enter into and execute a professional services agreement with Cook & Riley LLC for reviewing of the citywide sales tax return revenues. In 2015, the Board of Aldermen approved a confidential agreement between Cook & Riley LLC and the City of Brentwood, Missouri for monitoring services of sale tax collections received in the Brentwood Meridian Project. This project area is also known as T8RPA. The Ways and Means Committee has reviewed the budget, and a motion was made for it to be forwarded to the Board of Aldermen for consideration. We have with us this evening from Cook & Riley, we have Dan Cook and Steve
Garavaglia,
thank you. So if the board has any questions for either of them, or if the board would entertain hearing from them, Alderman Plufka.
I have a question for them.
Okay. Mr. Cook.
Yes.
Can you just explain for us the ways in which, or the expertise that you've developed in this area of practice, in terms of the kind of services that you provide for various communities, and then give us just a little bit about what you've done for other communities? And I think you've actually worked for the city of Brentwood in the past, correct?
I have worked, or our firm has worked for the city of Brentwood on a couple of occasions, and both involving sales and use taxes. In addition to monitoring the TA RPA here in Brentwood, we were involved prior to that as experts hired by your legal counsel when there was a court matter involving sales and use tax, and we were brought in at the recommendation of Stiefel and your counsel to provide expert testimony on this very subject of the tax flows from retail developments.
Sorry about that. Thank you.
So in the event that misreporting is uncovered, or there is money that was directed inappropriately, either by the state or by the county, or by the coding of that information at the business level, what is our opportunity to retrieve that money? What can we do with the information you provide as a result of this effort?
You would be able to go back to the Department of Revenue in Jefferson City, their state and local government unit that we work with very closely on not only this project but many others, and they would, if it was reported incorrectly, they would work with the other jurisdiction where the monies were sent, and that jurisdiction would have to turn those funds back over so that they could be correctly allocated if they indeed should have been allocated to this city.
Thank you. That's all the questions I have. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Are there any further questions? Alderman Dimmitt.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Cook, can you explain to me or to this board the benefit of us retaining the services of a law firm versus the services of a general accounting firm for doing what it is that we're looking at doing?
Well, I guess I'd go back to what Karen Shaw said before about one of the audit firms. We really do specialize in this. Our firm does state and local taxes. We specifically do sales and use taxes. My partner Scott and I have worked at three of the big five accounting firms, and at that point in time, I can tell you they don't do this type of work that we're talking about. We've also, I don't know if you had a chance to look at the CV we provided, we recently added Mr. Garvalia, and he was an accountant at Anheuser-Busch for 28 years, and prior to that, he was a sales tax auditor for the state of Missouri for several years. So we do have an accountant that works with very large databases and large tranches of data on our staff.
Okay, thank you.
Any further questions? Mr. Cook, thank you.
Thank you.
I think that's it for bills on the first reading. All right. Item number 11 on the agenda. Bills to be given a second reading. Item number 11A, Mr. City Attorney, bill number 6101 by title only, please.
Bill number 6101, second reading and consideration for adoption. As soon as I can get it. Bill number 6101, an ordinance authorizing the adopting of provisions for collective bargaining with law enforcement personnel.
I'm looking for the synopsis. All right, bill number 6101, provisions for collective bargaining with law enforcement personnel, second reading. This bill is for an ordinance authorizing the adoption of provisions for collective bargaining with law enforcement personnel. A recent Missouri Supreme Court decision requires municipalities to collectively bargain with law enforcement personnel upon request. The Eastern Missouri Coalition of Police, Fraternal Order of Police, Lodge 15, currently seeks voluntary recognition as the exclusive bargaining representative in collective bargaining, including bargaining regarding wages, hours, and working conditions for the City of Brentwood's police officers, corporals, sergeants, and lieutenants. Currently, Missouri law does not provide a framework for collective bargaining with law enforcement personnel. This ordinance is to establish a framework for collective bargaining in the absence of state legislative action. The proposed ordinance is modeled after one successfully enacted by the City of Grandview and upheld by the Missouri Court of Appeals of the Western District. Chair would entertain a motion.
Your Honor, I'll make a motion that the board perfect Bill 6101 into ordinance form.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the board perfect Bill number 6101 into ordinance form. Is there any discussion on the bill? Alderman Waggy.
So I guess I have an issue with Section 221. So that's the definition of the organization. So thanks for sending over Chesterfield's ordinance. I guess I've been trying to wrap my head around the definition of the supervisory positions, and it seems like we're going pretty far with corporals, lieutenants, sergeants, majors, and the chief of police. Just as a point of reference, I know we're using Grandview's ordinance as a lead on this, but the Chesterfield, you know, defined the chief of police, the assistant chief of police, and I believe sergeants only. So it seems like we're defining a large swath of the population here of splitting them, and it, I guess it's not clear to me how we're defining that.
Okay. Any further discussion?
Yes.
Oh, sorry, Alderman Kramer. My apologies. Alderman Kramer.
Just for a point of clarification, am I correct or am I reading this incorrectly? 6101 is amended or is it not amended?
It is amended.
It was amended at the last meeting.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Alderman Plufka.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I guess I would share Alderman Weggie's concern specifically as to corporals. As I understand it, that the designation of corporals in our police force, they are non-supervisory. And I question using as part of the logic for this, the notion of separating between supervisory and non-supervisory and then including in that list a designation that I don't think has any supervisory capacity in and of itself as far as the title is concerned. That's my concern. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Any further discussion? I would just say this to the board. I think, you know, we asked our labor attorneys to review the job descriptions associated with these positions and make a judgment call as to whether or not there's supervisory capacity or not. Whether or not there's actual supervisory duties included, the job description in fact does meet the supervisory requirements. So you're free to disregard the advice of our attorneys at your peril, but I would suggest to the board that that's been the determination of McMahon Berger, and I would encourage the board to go with that determination. Seeing no further discussion, we'll bring it for a vote. Roll call, please.
Alderman Plufka?
Yes.
Alderman Weggie?
No.
Alderman Lockmiller?
Yes.
Alderman Kramer?
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill?
Yes.
Alderman Leahy?
Yes.
Alderwoman Sims?
Yes.
Alderman Dimmitt?
Yes.
Okay. Bill number 6101 is hereby passed by the Board of Aldermen, and upon signature by the mayor becomes ordinance 4757.
All right, thank you. In proceeding with our amended agenda, the next item is bill number 6106. Mr. City Attorney, second reading by title only, please.
Sorry, I opened the wrong one. Okay, I did get the wrong one. Bill number 6106, second reading and consideration for adoption and ordinance authorizing a contract between the City of Brentwood and Brentwood Century Foundation for the purposes of providing certain services related to the city's upcoming centennial celebrations and events, and further authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to execute the contract on behalf of the city.
Thank you.
Motion, Your Honor.
No, I was just going to read the synopsis real quick.
Oh, I apologize.
Not at all. This bill, sorry, I was delayed again. I was trying to find my papers. This bill was for an ordinance authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to enter into an agreement with the Brentwood Century Foundation for up to $20,000 in fiscal year 2016 and fiscal year 2017 for services related to the coordination of the celebration of the city's centennial in 2019. Okay, now, go ahead.
Your Honor, I'll make a motion to perfect Bill 6106 into ordinance form.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the board perfect bill number 6106 into ordinance form. Is there any discussion on the bill? Alderman Lockmiller.
I'd like to offer an amendment to the bill.
Okay. Could you move your microphone up a little closer?
In order to fund for FY17, I would like to make a motion that the up to $20,000 be added under community services line, which is miscellaneous expenses. That would increase that line from $23,425 to $40,425. I'm sorry, $43,425.
I'm sorry, I'm waiting the outcome of the sidebar.
You're asking to amend the budget?
No, I'm just how this ordinance is funded for 2017.
He's providing clarification so that there will be a line item expense in the 2017 budget because at present it was not modeled in.
I'm just wondering which part of this bill or the contract is being amended.
Not this bill.
Not the contract, just the funding.
Just the funding.
Oh. So, yeah, I think he's suggesting that there be an addition to this ordinance.
Correct.
I'm with you on the amendment, but
it would. I understand, but I'm wondering if this is more appropriate to amend on the matter of the adoption of the budget. Okay.
We can go that way with it.
I understand that will unravel a lot more. Okay. Then perhaps it would be a motion passed by the board instructing staff to make appropriate arrangements to adjust fund balances for the funding of the contracted expenditure in 2017.
I'll remove my motion and insert.
All right, so let me
it's
take
perfectly a, acceptable let, saying what he said.
Let me take a crack at this. No. So we'll pass this. We will vote this ordinance as written, and then we would subsequently make a motion to direct staff to make the appropriate amendments?
Adjustments.
Alderman Leahy.
I'm not so sure you really want to make the motion the way you're headed with, because you're locking the funds into the 2017 funding arrangement, yet the contract goes 16, 17, 18, up to the
We have to come back each year for that.
Each year.
Yeah, the contract says we have to come back each year.
But to work it. So are you going to spend all $20,000 in the one year in 2017?
Up to, yes, up to.
In 1 year, you're going to spend the whole $20,000?
Up to.
I don't, the way the contract's written, it gives them the 3 years to accumulate.
No, it doesn't.
It does not.
I think that's, I think we had, didn't we have this question last meeting?
Isn't it $20,000 a year each year?
Each year. That's correct.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's correct.
I thought we discussed this last
No. In section 1, page 1, the purpose of providing certain services, celebrations, events up to $20,000 upon the receipts of all proposed budgets and future financing. That gives you a gross total of $20,000. That doesn't give you $20,000 for a 3 year shot at $60,000.
That was the intent.
It may be the intent, mm-hmm. but that's not the way this is written.
That's how I read it.
I'm reading it as being $20,000 for the 3 year.
Okay, well,
period.
When it comes to contractual interpretation, I'm gonna let the city attorney tell us what his opinion
then
is.
Then I'll raise the issue for the sure. for interpretation then, please.
That's fine.
I'm looking on page, I'm sorry, I don't see a page number, but it is.
Page 2 of the agreement.
The obligations of the city, numeral 2A, provide funding for services carried out by the Century Foundation in the amount of $20,000 each fiscal year commencing in 16 through 19 during the annual budget process, and authorize the funding of up to $20,000 to the Brentwood Century Foundation.
Do you also agree then, sir, that that section and section one of the ordinance disagree with each other?
I think it is annually, because again, you have to appropriate annually for this to be carried out.
So you're...
It may not be a model of clarity, but given the fact that you have to appropriate in order to fund it, I think it's inherent.
Are we good?
I
think the point he's trying to make is I think the contract calls for us to do up to $20,000 each year for 3 years, but you still have to appropriate every year because we can't make multi-year appropriations.
That I'll agree with.
Okay.
That's why I was looking at gross total. But when we first talked about joining into a group arrangement with the Centurion group, we were looking at spending up to 20. I'm not so sure that we understood or agreed at the time to go to a full $60,000. Now granted, it's $60,000 upon them presenting bills to that value.
Right.
They may never get there.
Right.
But I was under the impression that we went from a $10,000 to a $20,000 to make it the larger amount, but not per year. So I find that a little...
Well, the contract specifically requires appropriation every year. So I mean, we're only making a $20,000 decision for this year, mm-hmm. but that's what I understood as well. So,
okay.
But the most important thing to me is that you're clear on what we're doing. if you're not in favor of it, that's fine.
Last meeting, that's why I raised the question: if presenting city funds to the organization took along with it the requirement of 3 competitive bids and stuff so that they're spending public money with those requirements. Your direction at that time was that those requirements do not flow down.
Correct.
So the city is authorizing to spend up to $60,000 with this group presenting bills to us, but we have no control over any competitive or regular oversight to the spending being practical, reasonable, and best practices. And instead of being a $20,000 bucket, it's now a $60,000 bucket. I would like to see some type of cautionary group on that expenditure.
Okay. Alderman Lockwood.
Well, there is. Oh, go ahead.
I was just going to observe that the annual appropriation process, of course, affords you the opportunity to assess what it is they propose to do that year with your money and decide, do you want them to do it or not? I just observed that.
But that's assuming you know the bills that they'll be bringing in that fiscal year. We won't. We're giving them the authority to help pull together the whole program. And at the time that we're passing the budget in December of the year in front of it, we may not have knowledge of what they're going to be accomplishing in the year 2018, because the party is not until 19. Now, we assume that they're doing the best they can to make the whole program work, and I think they've got a good core group of people who accomplish it, but it's a little after the fact. That's why I was surprised that we went so large.
I understand. I'm not attempting to debate the merits of your view. I just wanted to offer the observation that one of the reasons for the annual appropriation system is to assess the merits of the proposed program.
Yeah. Alderman Lockmore.
Well, that's what he said. No, I'm serious. It was my intent that this would be an annual. We would look at this annually. It's going to be watched over by the communications committee. Receipts have to be provided during that year before funds under BOLA's or city administrator's direction are allocated.
And check me on this. If we were under the impression that the receipts were somehow funny, we would not reimburse them until we asked some questions. Am I right? Okay.
Well, yes, but at the same token, you've already given them the authority
to be the spending party.
All I have to do is bring to you legitimate paid bills that they incurred and ask for your reimbursement.
No.
You may review them and go, gee, this should have been lower, but the answer is this is the legitimate budget we spent.
No.
You've authorized it. Please pay up.
There's no question. We are definitely delegating that authority.
And I would like to put a little bit little bit more caption on it before we raise it. And at $60,000, you've given a larger playing field than at $20,000.
Well, again, the only matter before the board this evening is $20,000.
Is the bill, yes.
Okay. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, let's have a roll call, please.
Alderman Plouffe?
Yes. Oh, I'm sorry, Alderman Kramer. I'm used to looking peripherally, not ahead of me. Go ahead.
Just a clarification, point of clarification, Mr. Chairman, that the paperwork, does it show that there is the bill exactly that we're looking at now is already amended as of today, so the bill is amended or not?
The bill was amended because of a date change.
There's an amendment in the agreement dated today.
Yes.
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 There was something to do with the date. Yeah.
Date change.
All good?
Yes,
all right.
Sir.
Roll call, please.
Alderman Plouffe.
Yes.
Alderman Wege.
Yes.
Alderman Lockmiller.
Yes.
Alderman Kramer.
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill.
Yes.
Alderman Leahy.
No.
Alderwoman Sims.
Yes.
Alderman Dimmitt.
Yes.
Okay. Bill number 6106 is hereby passed by the Board of Aldermen, and upon signature by the mayor becomes ordinance 4758.
All right, thank you. Let's see, now we are on bill number 6105, which is 11C on the amended agenda. Mr. City Attorney, bill number 6105 by title only, please.
Bill number 6105, the second reading and consideration for adoption, an ordinance adopting the annual budget for the city of Brentwood for calendar year 2017 and providing for the effective date of this ordinance.
Bill number 6105. This bill adopts an annual budget for the city of Brentwood calendar year commencing on January 1st, 2017 through December 31st of 2017. Total revenue budget for all funds is $19,853,093. Total expenditure budget is $19,608,798. Notable additions to the budget include increased funding for street work to mill and overlay 25 streets, tree care and maintenance of 300 at-risk trees, and the addition of three new positions to increase provision of services. The Ways and Means Committee has reviewed the budget, and a motion was made for it to be forwarded to the Board of Aldermen for consideration. Chair would entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we perfect bill number 6105 into ordinance form.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the board perfect bill number 6105 into ordinance form. Is there any discussion? Alderman Lockmiller.
Once again, I'll fall back on our city attorney, but I believe since that the motion wasn't seconded and after the last ordinance, that I may need to do some type of funding.
I believe the proposed motion got sidelined in the discussion of the contract, and that the members' motion to instruct staff to make adjustments to the budget was not, I don't know that it was seconded, and I don't believe it was voted on.
Yeah, it actually, so what happened was he made a motion to amend. His motion was withdrawn.
Right.
Then there was a subsequent discussion, so we didn't actually have a motion on the table. What I thought we might do is hit that at new business.
I suggested to the member that he may wish to make it since it relates to the budget.
Yeah, that's fine. We could certainly do it that way. Let's see. Did we get a second on the motion to perfect?
Yes. Yes.
Alderman Wege.
Alderman Wege.
Yeah. So that's actually on the floor right at the moment. So, tell you what. Let's do this. Let's table the discussion of 6105. Right.
Yes.
If there's no objection, we'll put that on the table. Say again. Is there any objection to putting that on the table?
No. Why can he not make a motion to amend the bill that is up for consideration? You've had the reading, you've had the motion, and a second. It's open for discussion. He could make the motion to amend the bill at this point.
Right.
And that would be within terms of order.
I believe, once again, much like the last time, it's not really an amendment to the bill. It's instruction to staff as to how to proceed within the confines of the budget that you are about to adopt. So it's not it's not amending the budget per se with a specific line item. It's not amending the bill in terms of its text. It is instruction to staff as to how to carry out the last adopted ordinance and the budget that's about to be approved.
So I need to withdraw the original motion?
No. If there's no objection to tabling it, we'll table the discussion. We'll let you make your motion, and then we'll proceed.
New business. Bring it up at new business.
All right.
So go ahead and make your motion.
Do I have to wait till new business?
No. You can do it right now. That's why we tabled the other.
Okay. Well, my motion was originally to instruct, the city administrator to find funding for the ordinance, the bill we just passed, the ordinance we just passed, under her own discretion.
Okay, so the motion is to instruct city staff to make the necessary adjustments in the 2016 budget or the 2017 budget?
2017.
In the 2017 budget to accommodate the bill that was just passed. Is there any discussion? Oh, sorry.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion on that motion? Alderman Wege.
So are we looking to add that $20,000 into a line item in the 2017?
In lieu of telling them where to put it,
right.
Instructing them to put it into the budget.
Okay. Correct.
I think that's what we're actually trying to avoid is, go here and put it here.
Right.
As opposed to just telling them, hey, accommodate it.
Right.
Alderman Sims.
I'm sorry, what is the instruction? I've been following, but you lost me.
The instruction is the bill that was just passed.
Right.
For the up to $20,000.
With you on that.
All right. Has not been included in the 2017 budget specifically. So the instruction is for them to make the appropriate adjustments to the 2017 budget going forward to accommodate that. Because we really don't know where to, it's just now come up.
Right. Sounds good. Thank you.
Any further discussion? Alderman Kramer? I looked this time anyway. All right, good. All right, so let's see. It's a motion on the table. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Do we need this is money? No, we don't need a voice vote. So are there any opposed? Very good. The motion passes. So staff is so directed. Now, can I get a motion to take this up off the table?
Second.
Right. Is there any objection? Seeing none. Bill number 6105 is now before the board for discussion. Alderman Plufka.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I would like to amend the budget, to make a motion to amend the budget as follows, to direct the city administrator to set aside $50,000 payable to employees otherwise eligible for a pay increase, but who have attained the maximum range for their job within the city's compensation plan. The money will be paid as a non-base building bonus and does not represent an increase in salary, and each bonus will represent a proportional share from the fund not to exceed 1% of the eligible employee's salary.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that, let me take a crack at rephrasing that. That we authorize the board to authorize city staff to set aside up to $50,000 to be paid out to employees who are capped at a level of up to 1% of their salary or an equitable division of that $50,000 that's so set aside. That sound about right?
It does.
All right, very good. Is there any discussion? Alderman Plufka.
Thank you. I think the mayor said it well at the last meeting, and he said that we are a city that's in transition. We have moved into a market-based system for paying our employees, which I think is a good thing. I think that it is sustainable. I think it is well organized, and I think it will benefit the city in the long run. What I am concerned about, and the reason for my motion, is that I believe that in this process we have caught up a number of employees whose only real problem is that they did a good job and were paid and were offered raises and were offered additional compensation that put them beyond this range that we talk about in the compensation plan. I think we need to be mindful of the fact that these are people who have given, in some cases, decades of their life to service to the city. They plow our streets, they care for our parks, protect our homes and property, and even save our lives. I am in favor of the compensation plan. I do not believe this motion wrecks the compensation plan. I tried to craft it very carefully such that the money being paid here, first of all, it's not a very large amount of money that's even available for this. But secondly, it would be a non-base building bonus, a way to acknowledge to these great employees who have been otherwise capped because of their compensation to this point, that they would receive some recognition from the city that they're doing a great job. These are people who would otherwise qualify for bonuses or for raises because they have the certain amount of proficiency in the plan that's been set up by our city administrator and senior staff. We talk a lot of times about the differences between hard lines of investment, infrastructure, and soft lines of investment, our personnel. I would just ask you to consider the fact that when we talk about earlier tonight, streets and curbs being a priority and perhaps having to invest more money in that, it's people that are gonna pour those curbs and they're gonna pour those streets and they're gonna be the ones that are gonna tend our parks. And these are employees who are gonna carry out these basic functions. I am all in favor of infrastructure. I am all in favor of investing in that infrastructure. I just would like us to pay some recognition to the employees that we're gonna task with doing those things. Thank you.
Thank you.
If I may, Mr. Mayor, if I may inquire of the Alderman, the Missouri Constitution prohibits bonuses to public employees. You cannot pay a public employee additional compensation for services already performed. What I understood you to say was that you wish to incentivize the retention of experienced employees who have become capped out so that they will stay with the city and bring that experience to bear for the benefit. Is that correct?
That is.
Then if I may, I think the better terminology is that it is a retention incentive to be paid during the coming year. Would that capture the intent that the Alderman has?
It would, and if I altered that sentence to say that the money will be paid as a non-base building retention incentive, would that cure the concern?
That would certainly not be payment. Bonus implies payment for past service.
And I didn't mean to intend that. I meant to...
So I think this would articulate...
To look forward, not back.
...more in conformity with the constraints of the Constitution.
With the help
your,
of our...
Your motion will be so amended.
Thank you.
You made it, so you can amend it.
Okay.
All right. Is everybody comfortable with the amendment to the motion pursuant to the city attorney's quite prescient... reading of the Alderman's intent. I cracked myself up. Alderman Waggy.
I'm comfortable with it. I just have a question.
Yeah.
So when are we going to see the updated study of where the compensation falls relative to the comparator cities?
You will see it as soon as Ms. Higby returns from her vacation in the new year. So I assume very soon. I would guess the first week of January, second week of January. Alderwoman O'Neill.
My question is, where does the $50,000 come from? Is this something that has been designated as reserve, or from which line item does the $50,000 potentially come?
I don't believe that my motion has to direct where the money comes from. I would leave it to staff's discretion to put the $50,000. We have $4 million in reserve. I would think we could find it somewhere.
Thank you.
Any further discussion? Alderman Lockmiller.
When Ms. Higby gets back, I guess preliminary-wise, we've heard it'd be about a 1 to 1.5% increase.
Yeah, so I think I've shared with the Alderman at one point or another, and if I haven't, I'll share it with all of you right now. So I got a look at the preliminary data from Ms. Higby before she went, and... her data suggests that there is no need to adjust the seven-step matrix for market. In other words, we're still at or above where we want to be in the market as far as the 75th percentile and the 7-step matrix, which is uniform public safety. The 12-step matrix, on the other hand, her preliminary data suggested that it would be moved and by some percent, I think roughly a percent, percent and a half, something like that. I don't remember the exact number, but it was something like that in order to maintain the 75th percentile. And so I think when she gets a chance to present to the board, she's going to recommend that the 12-step matrix be moved, you know, 1 point whatever percent in order to keep us at the 75th percentile.
So looking at page 20 of the budget, everything in that matrix, grid, spreadsheet, whatever you want to call it, all those figures will increase next year by 1.5% or whatever they...
Well, they're only going to change if the board says they're going to change. I think that would be her recommendation in order to stay at the 75th
right.
percentile, yes.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Alderman Leahy.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'm going to ask for a little bit further clarification. You believe that her recommendation is that we would adjust all 12 of the steps? I thought when we talked, you were talking about just one category of all the steps.
No, she has some very specific recommendations on the 7-step plan that affect one or two classifications. She on the 12-step, it's an adjustment of the entire matrix, yes. And again, I think there was, we're still, at the time we had that discussion, I may have just gotten a look at that for the first time. So, does that help? I was trying to clarify, not kill the discussion. Any further discussion on the motion? Alderman Wagey.
So, if this isn't approved tonight, what would prevent us from possibly doing it next year? You know, after we get that data. I mean, with all due respect, I respect, you know, thinking and what we think the preliminary data is going to show, but I think getting the actual final study would be an important point to understand where the compensation plan is falling right now. So what would prevent us from, you know, instead of doing it tonight, possibly directing staff to do this next year at some point if we so decide?
I'm not aware of any reason you couldn't do that. Alderman Kramer?
Yes, Your Honor. I guess I wanted to reintroduce the question of the non-base building compensation factor and the compensation study philosophy as would be opposed or against that practice and how that would affect or impact our ability to maintain the rigidity of the compensation plan as we've passed it.
Okay. Well, for those of you, I mean, you know, there's no secret. I published a memo with the paper, for God's sake. So, I mean, you know, look, it's really, from my point of view, it's quite simple. It's, you know, I have no problem with non-base building incentives to employees who are capped out. Where my problem comes in is when those employees are capped out at well above the target range that we've set, right? So if those employees were capped out at the 75th percentile, right, then I would be all in favor of this type of measure. Unfortunately, the employees that you're talking about, most of them are capped out well above where we intend them to be. And so there's absolutely no market incentive to do anything of this kind. And that's, I just can't get around that. That's my point of view. I think that in that case, where you're talking about employees who are capped out well above where we intend to be pursuant to our market philosophy, that you are abandoning the market philosophy. If you give them, you know, non-base building incentive compensation when they're capped out at the 75th percentile, then you haven't abandoned your market philosophy. Now you're where you want to be, but you're, mostly what you're talking about is giving this to people who are well above where we intend them to be pursuant to the market philosophy, and I'm not in favor. But that's, like I said, just my opinion.
I would just, to Alderman Kramer's question, and perhaps some to some extent his point, I remember in Ms. Higbee's 2014 analysis, there was a whole section on non-base building incentives and how they do not do violence to the compensation plan.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. And like I said, were we talking about employees who are capped out at the 75th percentile top? I wouldn't feel the way I do. But I think that's, Alderman Kramer, does that answer your question? I mean, I think, you know,
yes.
Ms. Higby's report to us definitely included the possibility for non-base building type of incentive compensation. There's no question. And it absolutely doesn't violate market at all. Alderwoman Sims.
I have a couple questions. One, how was the $50,000 figure arrived at? And I guess two more philosophically, if we are going to be paying this money to people who are already capped out, how are we incentivizing them to stay if we're already paying them the most? I mean, I'm not understanding the process there. So could you flesh that out for me?
Sure. As to your second point first, I don't think this is necessarily. Sorry. Thank you. I'm sorry. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
I'm teasing you.
As to the incentivizing, other than the fact that I called it a retention incentive on advice of counsel, I don't know that it has a lot of market incentive to it. I'll admit that. And if the market analysis is correct, it has little or none. This is more about simply recognizing the fact that we are in the people business. I mean, I know there's been objections levied and there's been criticism levied by both people who have made comments and also by members of this board that we spend far too much of our gross income on employees. I have a hard time with that. To some extent, we are in the people business. This is what we are doing. The business of Brentwood is people. And I believe that 75% of our budget going to personnel and going to salaries and benefits is entirely appropriate. The $50,000 figure I came up with because I just did the shorthand math. I figured that under this, the way this is working out, there's going to be approximately 50 employees that are going to be capped out, that are not going to be eligible for any kind of raise under our current compensation plan. I figured none of them are making, or maybe one or two of them are making over $100,000 a year. So I figured 1% is less than $1,000 per person. That's how I came up with $50,000. It was nothing more mathematical or scientific than that. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further discussion on the motion? Okay, seeing none, I think we're ready for the question. The motion is to approve $50,000 to be set aside for retention incentive for employees who are capped out under our current compensation scheme. A vote in favor would be to direct staff to set aside the $50,000 as indicated. A vote negative would be against. Roll call, please.
Alderman Plufka?
Yes.
Alderman Wege?
No.
Alderman Lockmiller?
No.
Alderman Kramer?
No.
Alderwoman O'Neill?
No.
Alderman Leahy?
No.
Alderwoman Sims?
No.
Alderman Dimmitt?
Yes.
Motion fails.
All right. We are still discussing the budget. Right. So that was a motion to amend the budget? Yeah. So we are now back to the original question, which is bill number 6105, the annual budget for 2017. Is there any further discussion of the budget?
Call for the question, Your Honor.
You mean we've beaten this one to death? It only took 12 meetings, approximately 1 year of alderman life, and it's all right. Very good. The question's been moved and seconded, so we will have a roll call, please.
Alderman Plufka?
Yes.
Alderman Wege?
Yes.
Alderman Lockmiller?
Yes.
Alderman Kramer?
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill?
Yes.
Alderman Leahy?
Yes.
Alderwoman Sims?
Yes.
Alderman Dimmitt?
Yes.
We have a budget.
Bill number 6105 is hereby passed by the Board of Aldermen, and upon signature by the mayor, becomes ordinance number 4759.
I don't know. Was that technically a vote on calling the question?
Yeah, I thought that was just on calling the question.
This close.
Was that a vote on calling the question? That was a vote on calling the question.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
Nobody changed your mind.
Yeah, I jumped the gun.
Not there yet.
I should have made that a voice vote. All
right. Right there.
Point of order.
You guys have turned a half-hour meeting into an hour by now. I want you to know that, all right? All right, so.
If it's not gone long enough, I can jump in and screw it up.
I wish you'd jump into this seat.
Would humor be better than tension?
Absolutely.
Then we're doing fine.
It's imminently preferable. The sad part is this is all being videotaped. All right, folks. My bad. So that was a motion to call the question. The question's been called. We'll proceed immediately to a vote on the budget. This is a vote on Bill number 6105. Roll call, please.
Alderman Plefka?
Yes.
Alderman Weggie?
Yes.
Alderman Lockmiller?
Yes.
Alderman Kramer?
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill?
Yes.
Alderman Leahy?
Yes.
Alderwoman Sims?
Yes.
Alderman Dimmitt?
Yes.
Bill number 6105 is hereby passed by the Board of Aldermen, and upon signature by the mayor, becomes ordinance number 4759.
Nine. All right. Very good.
Your Honor, should it be noted that in next year's report that this is a milestone, we're back on getting it done.
Sure, we'll call this a new tradition. Seriously though, I want to thank the Alderman, particularly Alderman Dimmitt and the Ways and Means Committee. Really nice job leading the budget through the process, getting everybody's input, and I'd like to thank all the Aldermen for bringing a sense of willingness to work, express your ideas, but in a constructive manner, and work together to get this done. It was a pleasure working with everybody on this, and I think you're all to be congratulated for how you did it.
So.
Good. Mr. City Attorney, we're at item 11D, which is Bill number 6107. By title only, second reading, please.
Bill number 6107, second reading and consideration for adoption. An ordinance authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to enter into a cooperative agreement for the provision of technology services with the city of Clayton, Missouri, on behalf of the city of Brentwood, Missouri, commencing on February 1, 2017 and continuing in effect for a duration of 3 years.
Tom, are you having trouble hearing?
I'm having trouble hearing the city clerk, city attorney, and the folks basically on that side of the room.
Okay. If I'd ask everybody to, okay, so they're going to talk more into their microphones. That's the problem, is they're not getting to the PA, so you're not getting it here.
Thank you.
Yep. So, synopsis of Bill number 6107. This bill is for an ordinance authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to enter into an agreement with the city of Clayton, Missouri, for intergovernmental cooperation agreement for information technology services. Technological advances have changed many operations and aspects of businesses, both private and public. And because of increased demands for technology use and legal requirements, cities must engage highly skilled employees or consultants to perform technology services. It is challenging for individual municipal governments to obtain the most skilled IT personnel at a reasonable cost, and the municipalities participating in this agreement have determined that a cooperative arrangement is an efficient means for establishing and maintaining systems for the information sharing, public access, transparency, data storage, efficient governmental operations, and other functions. And Chapter 70 of the Revised Statutes of Missouri authorizes joint exercise by two or more municipalities to do this sort of thing. Local governments of any power common to them, with the approval of this agreement, the city will now have available staff with a variety of technical knowledge, skills, and experience. Beginning with this contract, current Clayton staffing will consist of an IT manager, a network engineer, associate network engineer, application specialist, and two IT support specialists, although exact staffing is subject to change based on need. I would entertain a motion.
No, you had first reading.
No, that's second.
Second reading.
Pretty sure. We're 6107, yeah?
Aye. Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to perfect Bill number 6107 into ordinance form.
Second.
Moved and seconded that the bill perfect, the board perfect Bill number 6107 into ordinance form. Is there any discussion on the bill? Seeing none, roll call, please.
Alderman Plufka.
Yes.
Alderman Weggie.
Yes.
Alderman Lockmiller.
Yes.
Alderman Kramer.
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill.
Yes.
Alderman Leahy.
Yes.
Alderwoman Sims.
Yes.
Alderman Dimmitt.
Yes.
Okay, Bill number 6107 is hereby passed by the Board of Aldermen and upon signature by the mayor becomes ordinance number 4760.
All right, thank you. Item number 12 on tonight's agenda, 12A, is Bill number 6108. Mr. City Attorney, first reading by title only, please.
Bill number 6108, first reading, an ordinance authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to enter into and execute a professional services agreement with Box Deal & Company PC on behalf of the city of Brentwood, Missouri for accounting services and further authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to execute a contract on behalf of the city commencing of January 1, 2017, providing accounting services for fiscal years 2016, 2017, and 2018, and providing for the effective date of this ordinance.
All right, thank you. This bill is for an ordinance to authorize the mayor to enter into and execute a professional services agreement with Botts Deal & Company PC for accounting services. The Ways and Means Committee has reviewed the bids, and a motion was made for it to be forwarded to the Board of Aldermen for consideration with a first and second reading on December 19th of 2016. If the board would bear with me, I'm going to ask the city attorney to read Bill number 6109 by title only, first reading, please.
Bill number 6109, first reading, an ordinance authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to enter into and execute a professional services agreement with Daniel Jones and Associates on behalf of the city of Brentwood, Missouri for auditing services and further authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to execute a contract on behalf of the city commencing January 1, 2017, providing for auditing services for fiscal year 2016, 2017, and 2018, and providing for the effective date of this ordinance.
This bill is for an ordinance to authorize the mayor to enter into and execute a professional services agreement with Daniel Jones and Associates for office auditing services. The Ways and Means Committee has reviewed the bids, and a motion was made for it to be forwarded to the Board of Aldermen for consideration with a first and second reading on December 19th of 2016. The reason I did those two first readings back to back is so that we could ask Karen or Bola any additional questions that you might have all at once, because I figured they're kind of related. So if the board has any questions, we've already had one shot at it. So, Mr. City Attorney, second reading by title only, Bill number 6108, please.
Bill number 6108, second reading and consideration for adoption. An ordinance authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to enter into and execute a professional services agreement with Botts Deal & Company PC on behalf of the city of Brentwood, Missouri for accounting services and further authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to execute a contract on behalf of the city commencing on January 1, 2017, providing accounting services for fiscal year 2016, 2017, and 2018, and providing for the effective date of this ordinance.
Thank you, and when you catch your breath, Bill number 6109 by title only, please.
Bill number 6109, second reading and consideration for adoption. An ordinance an ordinance authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to enter into and execute a professional services agreement with Daniel Jones and Associates on behalf of the city of Brentwood, Missouri for auditing services and further authorizing the mayor and or city administrator to execute a contract on behalf of the city commencing January 1, 2017, providing auditing services for fiscal year 2016, 2017, and 2018, and providing for the effective date of this ordinance.
The chair would entertain a motion to perfect Bill number 6108.
So moved, Your Honor.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the Board of Aldermen perfect Bill number 6108 into ordinance form. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, roll call, please.
Alderman Plufka.
Yes.
Alderman Weggie.
Yes.
Alderman Lockmiller.
Yes.
Alderman Kramer.
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill.
Yes.
Alderman Leahy.
Yes.
Alderwoman Sims.
Yes.
Alderman Dimmitt?
Yes.
Okay. Bill number 6108 is hereby passed by the Board of Aldermen and upon signature by the mayor becomes ordinance number 4761.
All right, thank you.
Your Honor, I'll make the motion to perfect Bill 6109 into ordinance form. I'm sorry, Tom.
Oh, Alderman Kramer, yes.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I had a comment before the last vote. It would have changed my vote, though, so it was more of a comment than a question. That is that our finance director made an excellent point of some of the reasons why the previous bill and this next bill contain options that are advantageous for the city. But I wanted to outline another one, which is that as fine as the services we've received in the past have been, in line with our state audit, in the past, this is another opportunity for a fresh set of eyes to take a look at the work of our city and offer some independent perspective and review. So I'm looking forward to these new companies. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bless you. Your Honor, for me.
Go ahead.
I'd like to make a motion to perfect Bill 6109 into ordinance form.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the board perfect bill number 6109 into ordinance form. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, we'll have a roll call, please.
Alderman Plefka?
Yes.
Alderman Weggie?
Yes.
Alderman Lockmiller?
Yes.
Alderman Kramer?
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill?
Yes.
Alderman Leahy?
Yes.
Alderwoman Sims?
Yes.
Alderman Dimmitt?
Yes.
Okay, bill number 6109 is hereby passed by the Board of Aldermen and upon signature by the mayor becomes ordinance number 4762.
All right, thank you. All right, item number 13 on the agenda. This is the last of our financial stuff for the year, I think. It's a resolution. It's the fiscal year 2016 budget amendment. So the way this works, folks, is every year we have a budget and we authorize expenditures along the way, and then at the end of the year we have to pass an amendment to the budget to sort of true everything up to what actually happened. So this is the budget amendment that would authorize the city to do the things that it's done along the way and make everything correct. So the resolution reads as follows. It's resolution number 1063. This resolution adopts the fiscal year 2016 budget amendment. Staff has reviewed the fiscal year 2016 budget amendment and budget and identified exceptions, increases and decreases in the revenue and expenditure line items that require amending. This resolution is to amend the fiscal year 2016 budget for the fiscal year which runs from January 1st through December 31st. The total general fund revenues and expenditures are $102,548 and $374,815 less than what was adopted and budgeted. The capital improvement revenue fund revenue and expenditures are $481,000, $125,000, and $136,900 more than what was adopted and budgeted. The stormwater and park improvement fund revenue is $263,421 less than what was originally adopted and budgeted. Also, the expenditures are $59,326 more than what was originally budgeted. Lastly, the sewer improvement expenditure is $10,770 more than were adopted and budgeted. The Ways and Means Committee has reviewed the policy and recommends approval to the board. I would entertain a motion to adopt resolution 1063.
So moved. Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the board adopt resolution number 1063. Is there any discussion? Fantastic. We'll have a roll call, please.
Alderman Plefka?
Yes.
Alderman Weggie?
Yes.
Alderman Lockmiller?
Yes.
Alderman Kramer?
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill?
Yes.
Alderman Leahy?
Yes.
Alderwoman Sims?
Yes.
Alderman Dimmitt?
Yes.
Okay, resolution 1063 is hereby adopted by the Board of Aldermen and on signature of the mayor.
It doesn't require a signature.
Oh, that's what I was just discussing with him. He said if I was wrong, we'd fix it later. So.
The form of the resolution has an approval by the mayor.
Seriously?
It does.
What if I don't approve it?
We'll have a constitutional crisis.
Yeah.
red or blue thing.
Well, let's just assume for the sake of argument that my pen is for sale. All right, accounts against the city, Alderman Dimmitt.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have reviewed the warrant list with our city administrator, and I would recommend approval of the warrant list in the amount of $117,833.81.
Motion to second your motion.
It's been moved and seconded that the board adopt the warrant list as presented. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, roll call, please.
Alderman Plefka?
Yes.
Alderman Wege?
Yes.
Alderman Lockmiller?
Yes.
Alderman Kramer?
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill?
Yes.
Alderman Leahy?
Yes.
Alderwoman Sims?
Yes.
Alderman Dimmitt?
Yes.
Motion passes.
All right, great. We'll pay our bills again this month. Item number 15 on the agenda, reports of committees and department heads. Under my report tonight, I have some exciting news. I've been working sort of, well, somewhat independently, but with city staff and some of the engineers that we've done business with in the past on the Manchester Road flooding issue. And I had a meeting this afternoon with some representatives from C2MH Hill. And I gotta tell you, for the first time, I have seen data that leads me to believe that we may be circling in on I hesitate to call it a solution, but a plan for Manchester, the south part of Manchester Road, and more specifically the flooding. I won't go into a lot of details because I think we're not quite there yet, but I gotta tell you, I reviewed with them the last three studies that have been done, and also got sort of a historic overview of the studies that have taken place. And I got to tell you, going into the meeting, I was sort of of the opinion that maybe we were in analysis paralysis, right? That we had studied this and studied it, and you know, but I think what I learned in the course of those couple hours is that I think what's been happening is we've sort of been peeling back the onion one layer at a time. There is a solution. There was a study, a comprehensive study that was done in 1988. That involved Metropolitan Sewer District and the Corps of Engineers channelizing the entire Deer Creek watershed. And that, when I say channelizing, I mean going in and putting in cement and running the whole thing. Folks, I gotta tell you, quite frankly, I'm not sure that project will ever happen. If it does, it won't be Brentwood driving the bus. that goes through about 9 municipalities that I counted. The cost in '88 was $35 million. I can't even imagine what it would be today. And quite frankly, with the environmental regs and so forth that have come into being since that time, I don't know that that'll ever take place. If it does, I'll welcome it with open arms because that would absolutely resolve the flooding issue on Manchester Road. But I got to tell you, I'm not going to pin my hopes to that bus. But what I did see was something that I think, like I said, I think for the first time in 2 years of working on this problem, I think I've finally seen the glimmer of a solution that might actually work for Brentwood. And it involves a lot. I mean, it's not simple. If there were an easy solution to this problem, it would have been solved a long time ago. But I'm excited because it really involves some changes to this area that could be very beneficial, I think, from a park and green space perspective and a redevelopment perspective, and give us, kind of what we talked about back in August, a true redevelopment of Manchester Road, particularly the south side of Manchester Road where the flooding is the worst. And so I plan on not keeping this all a secret. Like I said, I just kind of had the meeting this afternoon and got excited about it, and I do plan on sharing it with the board. What I've done is I've asked the folks at C2MH Hill to go off and do some very specific calculations on a few combinations of things that they haven't. They've done some calculations of this, and they've done calculations of that, and they've done calculations of the other thing. What they haven't done is sort of, you know, matrix them together. What if we did A and B and not C, or what if we did A, B, and C, or what if we did those types of things? And so what I've asked them to do is go off and do that. That's gonna, that, you know, they don't work for free, unfortunately. And so, you know, we'll be coming to the board to ask you to approve a budget to do that. Actually, I would entertain a motion. Am I getting a nod of the head? Yeah. I would actually ask one of you, if you're so inclined, to trust me a little bit on this one, to make a motion to approve us to go ahead and spend up to $35,000 for this final round of calculations. And I know, you know, like I said, I just had the meeting this afternoon across the hall, so I don't have any paper for you. But really what it would be is I think we would get the benefit of all these past studies combined into this one final set of calculations that would give us what I see as a real possibility for getting something done in that on that project. I would also share with you that I'm of the opinion that this appropriation, if you're so inclined to make a motion to approve it, could be funded out of the stormwater money that we've continued to set aside, because all of this is building on that capital improvement type of project. So if there were if that were something you were willing to do tonight, I think Bola would feel a lot more comfortable proceeding if she had the board's approval. But I will very candidly admit to the board that this is a pretty thin recommendation for that kind of money, but it is consistent with what we've already spent on similar studies, and I think it's absolutely necessary for us to get the benefit of the three or four studies that have been done in the past. Alderman Lake.
Thank you. Your Honor, I'm under the impression we are still under contract with C2HL.
We are. We would just have to approve the additional money.
This is just a work to be added as a work.
It'd be an additional work order, yeah.
Okay. Then I would not be opposed to making that motion to allow staff to proceed with contract to spend up to $35,000 on a finalization report.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that the board authorize the city administrator to enter into a work order with C2MHL to produce an analysis of flooding on Brentwood Boulevard that would include the previous analyses and provide us some detailed calculations with respect to those. Is there any discussion? Alderman Plufkin.
Do you have any idea of the timeline?
Yeah, they indicated that they were leaving for Christmas break fairly soon, so I'm guessing that nothing will get done in the next week. So my guess would be that we would see something late January timeframe. And I am very willing to, based on, you know, sort of, well, I'm torn. I'd like to share what I know with the board as soon as possible, but I'd also like to get the results of these calculations so I'm standing on a little firmer ground. But I would think the appropriate thing to do would be to kind of have everybody in a room and look at those at a future workshop in the not too distant future. Long answer to a simple question, sorry. Alderman Kramer.
Just a point of clarification, they actually have a base here in Columbia as well, CH2M Hill.
Thank you. I always get it wrong.
I do too.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, since it's money, I guess we'll take a roll call.
Alderman Plufka?
Yes.
Alderman Wege?
Yes.
Alderman Lockmiller?
Yes.
Alderman Kramer?
Yes.
Alderwoman O'Neill?
Yes.
Alderman Leahy?
Yes.
Alderwoman Sims?
Yes.
Alderman Dimmitt?
Yes.
Motion passes.
All right, I thank the board for trusting me on that, and I do believe that you it's well-founded. I think you're going to be as excited as I am when you see, you know, like I said, they're big plans, but they're doable plans, and that's, and the most important thing is I think we've got a real shot at actually getting something done on the flooding on Manchester Road, which has been a problem for more than 70 years, so that would be great. That's all I have in my report. Let's see. We're looking at Public Safety Committee. Alderman Plufka.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. In our January meeting, which I believe is January 19th, we will work to try and deliver a traffic calming plan to the Board of Aldermen for consideration.
Thank you. Public Works, Alderman Leahy.
Thank you, Your Honor. Two items, if I may. The Public Works meeting for the month of January will be Wednesday, the 11th at 4:30 here in the council room. The second item that I'd like to bring forward is I am making a request through the Board of Aldermen to do a community blood drive at the Brentwood Rec Center on February the 2nd, Groundhog Day, in the name of Lily La Martina and Christopher Leahy, my son. Both are suffering from leukemia and count on the blood banks in the hospitals to help them with transfusions and the infection fighting capabilities. The blood drive will be open to the entire community of Brentwood and a few of the neighboring parishes, Holy Redeemer, Immaculata, in this area, with the intent of trying to collect 100 pints of blood for the American Red Cross to help refill their needs. The American Red Cross states that there are about 5 million pints of blood needed each year in the United States through hospitals and emergency needs, and this would be a drive to help put some of the blood back in it. I ask the board for the use of the room C, I believe it is, the big room, in the rec center for the day of the 2nd of February at a no-cost charge as a community event for the city of Brentwood.
That's a motion, folks. Yeah,
it is within the Brentwood Parks policies to do such, but it does require the Brentwood Board of Aldermen.
Yeah. It's been moved and seconded that the board agree to waive the fee for the rental of the room for the American Red Cross to hold a blood drive on February 1st.
Second.
Oh, he already did.
Yeah, I did.
Oh, February 2nd. Sorry, Groundhog Day. You're like, second? I'm like,
I knew what he was doing.
Seconded.
I knew what he was doing.
Wow.
Too long of a meeting.
Yeah, well, I can't even say that. All right, so on February 2nd, is there any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor of waiving the fee, say aye.
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 Are there any opposed? Fantastic.
Thank you both to the board and to the Parks Department. I do appreciate the help.
That's all day?
There'll be between setup and blood collection. Right now we're looking at maybe a 1 o'clock to 8 p.m.
Okay.
But if we can actually get all the pre-registrations and get to the 100 pints and plus, the Red Cross will then look at bringing in a second staff so that we can even go further.
Okay.
And again, we have to work that out with the Parks Department that the room will be available the whole day. We know it is available for the afternoon sections.
Fantastic. Thank you. Everybody plan on rolling up your sleeve on February 2nd.
Please.
All right. Director of Planning and Development.
No report this evening.
Ways and Means, Alderman Dimmitt.
Nothing.
Mr. City Attorney.
Nothing, sir.
Madam City Administrator.
No report.
Deputy to the Excise Commissioner.
I yield to my boss.
Madam Library Liaison.
No report.
I don't have anything from the Municipal League. Chief, Historical Society?
Today's our birthday.
Hey, how old are you?
Brentwood is 97.
97 years old.
That's fine.
Happy birthday to Brentwood. Do we have any announcements? Alderman Lockmiller.
Ward 3 meeting. On December 27th, 7 o'clock right here, bring Christmas cookies.
Is that required?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Don't show up without cookies. Got it. Any further announcements? Any new business? Oh, sorry, Tom. No?
Felice Navidad y Prospero Año y Felicidad.
Muchas gracias, you too. Public hearing, any person care to address the board, come forward. You'll get 3 minutes to be on TV. Going once, going twice. Seeing none, any aldermanic response? Seeing none, we have no closed meeting. Could I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Your Honor.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we adjourn. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Are there any opposed? We're adjourned.